7 through 11?
Yeah, look, 14, 7 through 11.
When you put forth a parable to those which were bidden, can you mark how they chose out the chief rooms, saying unto them, when thou art bidden of any man to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room, lest a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him. And he that bade thee, and him come and say unto thee, give this man place, and thou began with shame to take the lowest room. But when thou art bidden, go and sit down in the lowest room, that when he that bade thee cometh, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher. Then shalt thou have worship in the presence of them that sit at meat with thee. For whosoever exalted himself shall be abased, and he that humbled himself shall be exalted.
That's right, if I go to someone's house and go in and have dinner, traditionally, the man figure sits at the certain seat at the table, right? And I go flop down there. So glad you invited me to the dinner. Oh, no, you gotta get up, that's Pastor Hill's seat. You sit down here on the far end from the potatoes. Well, we can pass you the potatoes. So, that's what he's saying there, don't just, you know, take it upon yourself, take the best. Go to someone's house, sit down with them, don't, you know, hey, man, that looks like someone's seat, I can see all the impressions there. Sure looks comfy, but I'll sit over here on the corner table, you know, until they invite me, Brother Williams, sit over here. Brother Williams, get up, I'm saving that seat for Greedy. You're in the way, get out of the way. You get embarrassed, that's what Jesus was saying, save yourself some embarrassment, be wise when you go places. How about the football, basketball game? Brother Travis, those seats look so good down there on the court. What happens if you go down there and you, it's getting to be about halftime, you throwing down the popcorn like you were paying $400 for that seat, and the family come up and say, they just look at you.
Excuse me.
Yeah, sure, that was, excuse me, that is. And show this, you know, season ticket holder, oh. You gotta get up. You better hurry up and get up. So don't go get the best seats, just 'cause you're there, you know. So that's what Jesus is saying, at least you're gonna be embarrassed. All right, praise God. Now, let's go with, before we finish this little section, let's go to Isaiah 11, chapter verse 1 through 5. Let's see if we can get back into wisdom, it's pretty quick. Isaiah 11, and 1 through 5. Okay, this is dealing with, if you're right, you can set up something that'll last, everlasting. Here's a prime example, what does it say there in Isaiah 11, 1 through 5?
And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall go out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. And shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ear. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked.
Right.
And the righteous shall be the girdle of his loins, and righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reins.
Okay, who are we talking about? Somebody's writing in the Old Testament. Who is this guy writing about, Brother Curtis?
Messiah.
Oh, you said Brother Curtis.
Cause he looked like.
I was in another world, I'm sorry.
Okay, I know, that's why I called you, I said, he looked like. How do I get back in this class?
I got a terrible headache, that's why, terrible headache.
Okay, who's the Old Testament prophet talking about?
That's
talking about the Messiah.
Talking about the Messiah. Talking about Jesus. He's going to do everything right, and he's going to be. He's going to. You know, nothing's going to keep him from having that everlasting kingdom, which is in fellowship with God forever and forever and forever, and ruling on the earth forever and ever and ever. Like the things that he has inherited, God gave him a name that is above every name. And for him to get that, he had to make sure he had he had to be polished up all the time, looking good, doing good all the time. So that's how he gets his everlasting position. Okay, praise God. Now, and it says that he should get what? Quick under what? Stand in. So we're back into the wisdom and understanding of God. He should get that. What about us? What about us? I make a wager today that most of us think you're going to have to labor and work, do something to get that kind of wisdom that even Solomon had, or even the kind of wisdom that even Jesus was awarded with. Oh, you got to get to work, get after it. Cost you a lot.
Greater things than Jesus.
It's going to get you a lot. Cost you a lot, Sister Shirley. Be as smart as Jesus. You're born in the bed of a child. You got a long way to go.
Well, here I go again. It doesn't come by osmosis.
All right.
It doesn't come by osmosis. You got
that. I'm thinking of one of my favorite scriptures. Redemptive reality. 1 Corinthians 1 and 30. Some of us sitting on $1 million on the moon. You could have been using that money a long time. We could have been in the Bahamas on our 40th anniversary. Oh, but y'all didn't use it. All. Got all this wisdom and ain't getting do nothing with it. Now all of a sudden you want to do something. You got old and author and everybody keeping up with you. He's author. Author writings. 1 Corinthians 1 and 30. What about us? Someone read it.
But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption.
And redemption. You already got it. You got it. I don't have to dig deep, search high. You already got it. What? Yeah, you got it. You got all the wisdom you need if you just use it.
Okay, here I go again. Ooh. You have that legally. You have that legally. But finally, you've got to search. And you've got to. It comes through painstaking effort. Legally, he's done all that for us. You're right. Legally, we do have it. But if we just receive it and don't do anything with it, then we remain like zombies.
Where you are.
Yeah.
Well, the lesson already told us in verse 4 that you have to take away the dross.
You got to polish yourself up.
Now that is work.
That is work.
Painstaking
effort. On you. Ain't that God that showed up? I made it more than possible. For whatever comes into your little noggin that you want to do, you have now made it more than able for you to do that. But if you got all kind of issues in the way, then God come down here and take away your alcohol. Take away the cigarettes. God, why don't you just come down and do that so I can achieve and obtain it?
That's where that dross is starting to come out. You have that ball sitting in front of you, and Lord, take it away. Take it away, Lord.
Okay, it's gone.
Yeah, it's gone.
Back again. There we go. He is made unto us our wisdom, and if you want it, whatever it is. Whatever. The depth, the height, the width, you got it. You can be like those fools that walked around the wilderness just a few miles away from the promised land. But for how long they waited?
40 years.
I'm almost like my class. 40 years. Just wait 40 years. Wow, you could have been ahead. Mm.
Okay, praise God. So if you want it everlasting, as soon as you want something that's going to happen for you and last forever, start polishing yourself up. Get that wisdom, and you got it. Because, beloved, it's God's good pleasure to do what? Give it to you. Okay. All right. Praise God. So it is better, verse 7 of our lesson, of Proverbs 25, for better is it that it be said unto thee, come up hither, than that thou shouldest, as we read that just a little earlier. Let's look at verse 8. Okay. Good word here. Good word. Sometimes I have to take heed to this one. Because I have a habit of speaking my mouth. I'm prone to do that. Nobody else is. Prone to say it before you think about it.
Are you?
That's not always like they wisdom to do that.
Like they know me. Okay. What does it say? Verse 8.
Go not forth hastily to strike, lest thou know not what to do in the end thereof, when thy neighbor hath put thee to shame.
All right. Now we got a lot of stuff in here, some civil stuff going on. Watch out. I'm going to sue my neighbor. Suing State Farm. Put the roof on right. Didn't pay for the busted pipe that messed up the carpet. Didn't do all this. I'm suing somebody. I'm suing somebody. And he's saying here that you better make sure you got your act together before you go what? Sue somebody, because the court system is going to embarrass you. And then if you get up there and lose, guess what else you got to do? Pay. So if you get mad, you better make sure that you are right. Let's see what he says here. Go forth not hastily to strife, lest thou know not what to do in the what? In thereof. Oh, I'm going to jump in the middle of this. Oh, how do I get out? It hit me upside my head and everything else. I should have let this thing alone. When thy neighbor hath put thee to what? Shame. So, your neighbor got a barking dog, you tired of it, you going to sue him. You call the cops on the neighbor because his jalopy is parked across the yard. Sister Hill's neighborhood. Left oil stains all over, but she's shooting at it. She's mad. I'm going to give him a piece of my mind. Park that thing right there in front of my house. Go over there hastily.
I'm laughing because that's no, I'm not. Wait.
Right over there.
I didn't give anybody a piece of my mind.
You
didn't
get that thing about it. I'm suing you. See if we have an example in Proverbs 25, 8 through 10. Well, that might be what we do. Oh, we'll stay right there. Yeah. Okay, so don't act so quick to get into an argument, confrontation. Verse 9, debate thy cause with thy what?
Neighbor.
Him what? Himself. Yeah, I think Sister Hill got a homeowners association up there. Mm-hmm. Got a nice looking yard. Some of them up there, if I was living up there, I'd have been called.
Yeah, that's what
you got to do. That guy ain't cut his yard, that one, and trees. Oh, get on the phone. I got to pay my dues. They ought to be. No. What are y'all doing? Wait a minute. Go talk to your what?
Neighbor.
On my block, Brother Al, there's three very, very bad yards. And they all belong to Caucasians. Go figure. Never looked at anybody. Had the whole candy. No, don't call. She wants to call. It's cold enforcement. Brass got up out that high. Pallet, wood pallets up in the front yard. But because they're large. One car in the drive don't work. We never have to. She ain't talk to him. She sure wanted to call enforcement. So, she had it. I mean, she was right. She was right. But why can't they cut that grass? What's wrong with y'all? They handicap? I don't know. Scared of lawnmowers? I don't know. Something about the... I need to find out, I guess.
We found out from the neighbor across
the street. One of the neighbors across the street lent him his lawnmower. I said, well, she got out there. She got out there.
But wasn't able to do it because it was too big.
It's too high.
So what you telling me, they didn't have a lawnmower?
I guess. I do remember when my lawnmower broke down some years ago and I couldn't, you know, get neighbors in warm zone. It's getting hot. I went to the AAA, rental or somebody. And rented them. All $15-$20 and I got the
They might didn't have the money.
Gotta go talk to him.
Right.
No, I'm just gonna take him to court. I ain't got time for talking. Anybody can see that grass getting cut.
Please tell me about it with time.
A good neighbor would go and cut it.
Let's go.
I just went over my mouth there. That's the same thing I was thinking.
Debate thy cause with thy neighbor directly. That's what the word says.
A neighbor next door, he was old. And
that's what the word says.
Yeah, if they can't do
go to him directly. Don't go to court. Go to him directly. What about they bumped into your brand new Mercedes? Black, shiny Mercedes.
He called State Farm, so he's a good neighbor.
I'm calling my lawyer. Yeah. The word says what? Go to him what? Directly. Even if you got a cause against your what fellow brother in the Lord. He owed me. He ain't stepping up. He owed. Yeah, I got the goods on contract right here. I'm a blasting out in church. First time I get up to testify. Hold it. Okay, let's look at Matthew 18, verse 15. And we have these answers already within us if we would pray and slow down. Let the Holy Ghost work with us because we're New Testament believers, but sometimes we just look at it and say, no, this is the thing to do. We do live in a free society, is that correct? Yeah? A free society requires regulation. If my neighbor's dog is barking at nighttime, there's a regulation that says I can't go over there and just shoot him. So you got to have rules and things of order. So Jesus said, do it like this, 18 and 15. What does it say there?
Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. You want me to read further?
Yes, sir.
But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established.
Okay. And the end of verse 9 says, and discover not a secret to another. In other words, if you know some dirt on your brother and sister, they haven't measured up. It's don't go broadcasting it when you get into an argument or dispute. Mm. Not only do they owe me money, guess what else I know about? First chance I get to testify. Guess what else I know about? So Jesus said, keep it what? Secret. Keep it secret. And if the Lord knows that you cannot keep a what? Secret. We gotta speed it up. He don't see how you can have and manage the higher things in life. So there's some secrets. But y'all know about me, I can't tell nobody. Maybe you can't go tell Terrence. So you know what? Keep it away. Secret. If I get him in court, I'm gonna sell him. First chance I get. No, Jesus said. That's what these are the rules of the New Testament.
Can't put it in your memoirs either.
So, okay, verse 18, 15. Okay, praise God. So, now, if you need something that was pretty serious, go get you another trusted, mature saint to discuss it with all of y'all together. And he says that if you can get it settled, you what? You gain the brother.
Gain the brother.
But if you can't get it settled, you go get some witnesses and then say, now see, in case it get out that I'm in the wrong, I got two or three other people who will keep it a secret, but they know the real story. In case it comes up some other time that, oh, well, I got some witnesses that can testify to that situation. If he's still lying over there. So this wisdom that Solomon is trying to tell us about, yeah, it was very good to have and to know, and to that's a blessing. But New Testament believers, we have so much wisdom, godly wisdom, and the apostles who founded the early church assembly pray for us to know these things, have this stuff already in you. You know, let's say, well, I'm going to start searching now how to have wisdom. I think that's too late or too early. I'm searching now. I'm going to start searching for some wisdom. How long have we been married, Candy? That's not wisdom. I should know. 34, 5 years.
36.
Well, I think I start acting like a good husband.
38.
You think that's kind of late? I'm going to start taking her to dinner. You think that's kind of late? So she'll love me. I think we'll have some more kids.
Yeah, it's too late.
So it's got to be timely. Some folks want to act on wisdom. Guess what? Too late. Not everything, but some stuff is too late. What would it take to repair all that damage? Right. I should have been walking in some. You ain't got time. Oh boy.
Yeah, we got some relatives.
Oh boy, I'm on my deathbed, lungs all clogged up. Thank God to get rid of this pack of cigarettes. Got the oxygen tank on me. Thank God. We thank God to get rid of these cigarettes. Yep. Well, I don't know. You might want to keep puffing them. Too late. Ooh-wee. Okay. A word fitly spoken in what? It's like apples of gold in a pitcher of silver. Somewhere in the Bible says a good word at the right time. Oh, how precious it is. I can't think of that. But a good word spoken. Wisdom, action spoken and received at the right time. Oh, how precious it is. Hey, Williams, you should go to college. Get that business degree. What about that? Too late.
Well, it's not too late.
I'll do it. Spend 4 more years in college and get that degree.
Never too late.
You know.
You know now.
Yeah, I got it with you.
Yeah,
so that's okay. The deal about wisdom is that it's timely. It's good when you use it time and you wait too long to apply it. Might be too late. It'll work for somebody else. It'll work in the earth, yeah. But for you, it just might be too late.
It's Proverbs 15:23.
Okay, what does it say there?
A man has joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season, how good it is.
In due season. Think I'll go try out for OU. They got a good team this year.
Go on, Beauty. Me and you. Me and you, Brother Beauty. You be the running back, I'll support.
All right. We'll run the wishbone.
Yeah, the wishbone. Too late.
Oh.